Okay, in the building today we have Australian flatland legend icon Simon O'Brien along with his good friend Bobby Carter. How's it going, guys?
Cool. Good, man. How you doing?
Excellent.
Good, good. Yeah, stoked. Thanks for having us.
Yeah.
Stoked to be here. Stoked to be in LA.
Hey, I'm always happy to have one of my countrymen, fellow Australians out here. What brought you out to LA in the first place this time around?
Yeah. So basically, the main reason I'm out here is my brother's been living in Denver for a couple of years. He married an American girl, and they're going to have the celebration. So instead of wanted all his family to come out, and I was like, well, you know, I'm not going to America and not going to stop in LA, so I 100% had to stop here. And
is this like one of your favorite places to ride, generally speaking?
Yeah, absolutely.
Best it's, scene in general?
Yeah, here, basically, the West Coast and Japan, but like, you know, you got the Long Beach crew and all the guys in LA. That's sick. I love it.
So let's talk about how you first got into this BMX thing in general. Like, what was your first, the first thing that got you excited about riding bikes like this?
I don't know. I think just you have something ingrained in you that, you know, you take a liking to BMX. One of the main sort of things I can remember was watching like a TV sports channel, or TV, like just show actually. And there was a clip from Head First and some footage of Dennis McCoy doing like shows and that and I was just like, you know, that's what I want to do. I just knew that's what I want to do.
So. Right, so you just went out and got a bike and started riding. Were you riding everything at first?
It didn't happen instantly like that. I sort of I was lucky enough to bump into a couple of guys that sort of pointed me in the right direction, sort of, you know, gave me a couple of guys to ride with and just basically helped me take my first steps in the BMX sort of, yeah, scene.
Do you remember like what the scene was like? What was the city that you grew up in?
I live in like a coastal, like there's 500 people there.
Right.
A small coastal village. So there's a few good dirt jumpers and street riders that come out of there, but there's no flatlanders. It's just a bush, you know, there's nothing there,
right,
really. So maybe that's what helped me get so good at riding, the fact that
there wasn't a whole lot going on outside of that. So yeah. Do you remember like a specific time that you started to go in a flatland direction that sort of became your interest?
You know, as every kid does, jumping curbs, all that sort of stuff. I didn't really take a decision at that point to continue, but I remember at the age of 14 I was like, yep, you know, this is what I want to do. I'm going to really try. And then, you know, after that, hanging out with some guys in the local town, watching some Dorkin videos, and that they were a huge inspiration.
Right. What was it about those videos, and was there any specific inspiration you took from them?
I don't know, the fact that they look like they're having so much fun. And
yeah, I was going to say that's kind of what usually people say when they talk about the Dorkin videos or like a lot of early freestyle videos, is that was the impression people got, that it was just, this is insanely fun and just looks like a blast.
Yeah, absolutely. And probably Mark Eaton's video skills had a lot to do with it. You know, right, just the way he put it together was just epic, so good. And yeah, just the creativity of those guys, like, you know, just, and the music, like, you know, just like the Baco videos, like, just amazing music, you know. I think that played like a very big part in it. So
could you identify anything like about yourself as a person that you think made you more likely to become a flatlander? Like I think a lot, like, what are the assumptions people have is that flatlanders tend to be like more to themselves, or they don't mind being alone for long periods of time. Were you always kind of more like that?
Growing up where I grew up, like, there wasn't really any other riders that I could, you know, go hit dirt jumps and sort of do more skate park, where if I get hurt, there's going to be other people to sort of help me out.
Right.
So flatland was like, it doesn't matter. Like, I'm not really going to get really hurt. So right. I can just go and do that. So
you think you were kind of risk adverse from a young age, so you weren't really that interested in getting hurt?
Yeah, I did for a while, for like And even to this day, I still do a little bit of mini ramp if I can, try and sort of add a little bit of flatland into it as well. But yeah, basically, like, I didn't, being out in the that sort of a urban, you know, bush coastal area, sort of, you know, like, I just didn't want to get hurt really if I could avoid it. So, but at this, you know, having said that, I really took a liking to flatland.
Right.
It's just, I thought it's just, you know, you and your bike and you're making something look amazing. Like, I just, that drew me to it.
So, so what were your early days like riding flatland? Like, do you remember where you would go? Like, how would you engage with it?
Sort of, yeah. So being a coastal area, you know, there's no real sort of infrastructure and no car parks really to like accommodate my riding. So I just ride like on just the, you know, streets sort of thing and just dodge the cars and whatever and just pick a less less busy street. And streets are pretty terrible around there as well. Like,
oh, really? So it's hard to even find a decent parking lot?
Yeah, it's real bad. And then after some years, I sort of saw a school, a local school, that I just sort of went up to the basketball court and it just turned out good and sort of started using that. And then that became one of my favourite spots until just recently when they sort of built a big black spiky fence around it.
Really?
And so, yeah, I can't ride that spot anymore, unfortunately.
So how many years was that that you were riding it? You just made it sound like it was like a couple decades.
Yeah, probably like 16 years old to 35.
Really?
Yeah,
damn.
just recently.
And did anyone ever like acknowledge you during that time and say like, you know, hey, you're using this space more than anyone else who is technically allowed to use this space? Or was, do you, no?
Yeah. There was some jackass security guards around that are trying to kick me out and the police every now and then. It was pretty cool because, you know, I wasn't doing anything wrong. And so, but once I started having that bit of trouble with those guys, I went to the vice principal and like I paid like $2 fee for a year and he just wrote me out a slip saying
he had a form prepared for flatlanders who wanted to use the basketball court.
Nah, I just sort of like
$2, it seems like kind of an arbitrary amount of money to arrive at.
He basically did it just to say that I had paid rent for it.
Okay.
And then he just like did this written handwritten sort of slip to saying I'll give permissions for Simon to.
That's cool. It's like a license to kill. Just you have that in your backpack and just the cops can't say shit.
Yeah, exactly. It's so good.
When did you first start to like travel to ride with more people and stuff like that?
My first international trip was 2000. That was to America.
Okay.
You know,
but were you traveling around Australia before that? Like
a little bit, not a great deal.
Was the Australian scene good at the time, or did it strike you as like, oh, like I could go drive 8 hours and ride with this guy or this guy? Or?
Yeah, yeah. Probably back then, the flatland scene was a bit better than it is today. Today it's sort of lacking. But yeah, back then there's a few other good riders and a bit more of a community sense, I guess.
Right.
but yeah, I guess what I really wanted to do was travel to America because, you know, like in Australia, back then when there was no internet and stuff, you'd see the BMX Plus ride.
So, what was your impression of America as a person just looking at it from afar like that? You thought it was heaven on earth?
Yeah, pretty much. It's like, I think any BMX would be like, that's, you know, LA, America, this is where it's all happening. So
how did it just real quick, how did it compare, like once you got out here, after you were here for a few days, were you as impressed as you thought you were going to be, or was it kind of like, oh, this is actually just a regular place in some ways?
My very first trip I flew into Greenville.
So you started there, so that's a little bit less like paradise than LA.
Because Colin McKay was sort of hooked us up, helped us out in that. And so it was good to have that home connection in America. So when I transferred in LA, it was like, this is like surreal. Like I've just walked into the movies sort of thing. Like,
right. Even in the airport or when you got off the plane?
A bit in the airport. Yeah, for sure. And like, just like, for instance, just seeing a cop car.
Right.
You know.
And it trips you out because you've never seen a cop car that looked anything like that except in a movie.
Yeah. And you're just like, wow, I just walked into a movie.
So who'd you hang out with when you first came to LA?
Probably Chad. Okay. We sort of met up at Raleigh. Like, Raleigh was my first contest, a CFB at Raleigh.
Okay. And what year do you think we're talking here?
2000.
Okay.
So I met all the Flatlanders. I did a bit of traveling with Nathan Penenzek.
Uh-huh.
And so we traveled up the up and down the East Coast a bit. Then made it out. That trip, I took two bus trips on Greyhound. And I took a bus trip from Greenville to Vancouver. It took me like a week. It was the worst. And then I took a bus down to Huntington. And I stayed with Alan Cook for a bit. And then, stayed with Chad in Long Beach. And then, back over to Pennsylvania on a bus and sort of, not long after then left. But it was, that being my first big trip.
And how long did that last in total?
3 months.
Okay.
Yeah. But, the first sort of week was a bit, I don't know, being away from home. I was a little bit homesick, I guess.
Right.
But then, 2 weeks into it, I was like, yeah.
Yeah, 3 months is a pretty long first trip.
Yeah.
But then again, I guess doing Australia to America, you have to stay for a while, otherwise it's not worth a fucking expensive-ass plane ticket, huh?
Yeah, absolutely.
It must be kind of trippy being a flatlander and traveling, because then you, essentially end up riding, spots that probably feel very similar. It's just a complete change of scenery and, the food you're eating and the schedule around it. Was it a shock to you, or was it just pure awesomeness?
Pretty much pure awesomeness. It was so good. Like, it was, just like supermarkets, all different foods and that. And, for the last 9 years, I've missed the Mexican.
Oh, okay. So you're a big fan of Mexican burritos. Food? Yeah. What do you order, if you were to go to a Mexican place right now?
A nice burrito. Yeah. We in Australia, you can't get the big
Oh, you can't get tortillas, in that size?
They're
really?
They're, this big.
Really?
And just what do you do with that?
Yeah.
There's not much. And so for 9 years, I've been just
You were thinking about burritos the whole time? Damn. You don't have Chipotle out there or anything?
Because,
It's not that bad. It's pretty close to a real burrito.
Yeah. Well, we got one place in Sydney that I know of that I think is not too bad, but it's, super expensive.
Mexican food traditionally is just, it doesn't seem like they can pull it off anywhere else in the world. I don't know what it is. I went to England and someone told me, this is the best Mexican place in this city. And it was probably the worst Mexican food I've ever had, which it doesn't really make sense to me, why they couldn't pull it off somewhere else. I don't know. It's a weird thing.
He's been sampling burritos every day.
Oh, yeah? You get three places. Different ones and take a few bites each one.
We got to go back to the taqueria in Long Beach.
Which taqueria? There's a lot.
4th Street, Coronado.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. That place is amazing.
Nice.
So good.
We go to 10th and Temple when I'm around there.
All right.
Yeah, that's a good one. Yeah they are all quite similar. Yeah. But you do that first. Well, can we talk about getting coverage? Were you getting coverage before you came to LA, or is that the first time you really started to get noticed?
Yeah. that was... Yeah, my first pretty much time to get coverage. A little bit back home, but the internet wasn't around really, so stuff like that. But yeah, that trip was awesome. It just helped me get for my first sponsor, my first Japanese bike sponsor.
And who was that? Aries?
Aries, yeah.
Yeah. And so was that a good deal? Was that how does it work being an Australian guy riding for a Japanese company? It must be kind of strange.
Yeah. Yeah, it worked out. I was with them for 2 or 3 years, and they paid for some flights, gave me a bit of cash, bikes. It was good. It was actually a good deal. So
that's dope.
That actually, paid off because they took me to Japan my first time and loved that country. And it was just it was good. Just that first trip to LA. It was awesome.
Right. So what kind of coverage did you end up getting out here? Just were you in videos, or did you get anything in magazines?
Yeah, in the Intricate videos, BMX Plus, Ride, just I was very lucky. and very stoked.
So what was it like going back to your Australian BMX life after the time spent in LA?
It's crazy. The first thing, when I got home, I was like, where is everybody? Like, there's so many people in America.
Right, yeah.
Australia's, you know, there's nobody. And I was just like, wow, it's crazy. But I hadn't... once I got home, I was like, all right, I'm getting a good job and I'm going to save and I'm going to keep traveling.
Right.
That, like, that trip was just, like, made me catch the travel bug.
Right.
And ever since then, I've just been, yeah.
So what was the job that you ended up going home and getting? Because is it hard to have, like, a serious career when you're also riding flatland all the time?
Well, probably the trip before America, I sort of tried to ride as much as I could to get my skill level up. So I didn't want to embarrass myself coming out to the American scene. So when I went home, I got a supermarket job just so I could work, you know, nights, still ride through the day. And then I also got another job at a bike, or had sort of this bike shop work going on. So sort of the two together just saved all my money. And then sort of the next trip after that was, I think it was Europe. Yeah, or it might have been Japan for 2 weeks, and then I'd been saving for Europe, and then I went to Europe for 5 months.
Nice.
So that was good. And that was, yeah.
How do you compare, like, the European flatland scene to the American BMX scene out in LA and stuff?
I don't know. There's probably maybe more riders in Europe.
Uh-huh.
And maybe more accessible to each other, you know, the countries being
it's
so
much smaller and closely condensed. Yeah.
But, I don't know. Like, I just like being in LA. So that's, but I wouldn't really, you know, rate one or the other, because you've got some absolute legends that come from America and, you know, amazing riders, legends from Germany. I mean, Europe as well, but I don't know. It's hard to, you know, say one or the other, really. It's all good.
What like, during your most hardcore times riding flatland, like, especially when you're younger and stuff, what would, like, a normal, like, you said you would go to those basketball courts, but, like, how many hours are we talking that you would probably practice in an average day?
Probably the time that I really was trying to ride, I was, like, doing, like, 5 or 6 hours a day. If I was with friends, maybe more.
Right.
Just, you know, hanging out, riding, sort of not as much ride time, but it was good. I enjoy riding by myself because just can sort of knuckle down and just, you know, work on stuff.
Right. Yeah.
You know, sometimes, like, when you're in a crew, you just want to stop and talk and stuff.
Are you the kind of guy that if you're in a parking lot for 5 hours and you have a trick that you want to pull, that you're only doing that trick? Like, you just get straight up into the zone of, like, I'm going to learn this, and that's why I'm here.
Pretty much, yeah. I will, but I find if you concentrate on the one trick for an extended period of time, you just sort of burn yourself out.
You start to get worse at it.
Yeah.
Or at least that's how it is for me. I've seen a lot of people over the years who, like, maybe are trying a rail trick, and it's, like, a crazy long grind or something, and they just keep getting better and better at it. And I just... You know, after many hours, they're still, like, getting closer and closer. And for, like, I think normal people, that's kind of a baffling concept, to me at least.
Yeah.
Simon, can you talk about your riding spot that's, like, right in front of your house?
Oh, so
and
you're...
how that happened and, like, what it did for your riding?
Yeah, what's this about?
Yeah. So, basically, the fact that I rode on the streets of...
Which is a funny idea. It's kind of funny to picture you, like, in front of a bakery, like, doing flatland because you didn't have anywhere else to go
It was more like there's one corner store where I live, pretty much.
Oh, okay. So it's that rural. All right.
So, like, you know, there's kangaroos hopping down the street and
literally?
Stuff.
Literally?
Yeah.
Wow. That sounds pretty cool.
So just, like, you know, suburbia. So just in front of houses or whatever.
Well, there's no kangaroos in our suburbia, but...
They come out in the evenings.
Really?
Yeah.
Downtown Long Beach, you got to be careful.
Yeah. Sure. So it was like I was probably having a whinge to mum or whatever around that time. And just I've got 4 brothers, so we talked about it and we invested this, like, $6,000 to build this concrete slab in our front yard.
Really?
7 meters by 13.
Uh-huh.
And this probably did this in 98 or 99. No, Oh, yeah, 97.
So you're the first person that you ever knew of to do something like this? Because I've seen other Flatlanders do it since, but you've never seen anybody else do this before?
Yeah, I think they started copying me. And, but, yeah, we did it ages ago. And, you know, set a basketball ring up and built this wall. So it's all graphed up. And you can play tennis against it.
Okay.
Painted some cricket stumps on it.
And your brothers helped you with this? But they didn't ride Flatland, right? They were just, they just assisted you in, because they believed in your talent?
No. They usually would fight, actually, once it's done. Like, they'd want to play cricket.
Oh, okay.
I'd want to ride.
So right, yeah.
That'd be arguments.
What are your brothers like, real quick? Like, is this... I'm just imagining you now having these, like, crazy Australian brothers who are just beating the shit out of each other and just something like that.
Yeah, pretty much. They're bigger than me, a lot stronger. One's in construction. He's a qualified painter.
Okay.
The other one, ex-army.
Oh, okay.
He did a Timor in Afghanistan. Now he's in construction as well. The next one, who's in Denver, uni student, sort of, he's working in a hostel at the moment. The next one, and the youngest, he's working in construction as well.
So what do your parents think about what you've done with this whole Flatland thing in comparison to, like, your brothers? They think it's pretty strange, or they think it's cool?
Mum was always real supportive, like, you know, follow your dream. She was a bit of a hippie sort of style.
That's good.
And, which is good, but sort of now, at the age I am, I wish I sort of would have done a uni degree or something. But you know, I'm still, no regrets, really, you know. But, they're supportive and, you know, just, you know, you got to do what you got to do, really.
So did this slab, did it change your life, like Bobby said?
Yeah, absolutely. Riding-wise, like, I could, you know, if, you know, I wasn't arguing for trying to get it off my brothers, but they weren't on there all the time, but can ride whenever I want from dawn till dusk. You know, it's set the graffiti up, make it look cool.
Right.
It's just all, yeah, it's amazing. It's the best, like, just your own personal riding spot to do whatever. Yeah. Right. And if it rained, it dried super quick, just because, you know, it's, yeah, it just did. And yeah, it was awesome.
So what year did you start making your first solo DVD? Because this is a very interesting concept to me. Am I jumping ahead too far to bring this up, or is that, like, relatively close to, like, your first trip to LA and stuff like that?
Yeah, probably my first video I did in 2006?
Was that
2005,
2006?
Yeah, 2006, I think, yeah.
So that was after X Games and all that.
Yeah, it's 2006.
Oh, so we should talk about X Games, too. That's a good point.
Gold medalist.
Yeah, gold medalist. What year was that?
2003.
And what was that like, going through that experience? Because did you see this coming? Could you have expected that you might win the whole thing?
It was phenomenal. Like, never in my wildest imagination, like, from a small town in Australia, would I ever think that, you know, you could go and win an X Games gold medal.
Right.
And so going into the contest, I had no expectation because I'd been in Greenville sort of for... it was actually a really weird time. I was in America for a while before that, and then I had to fly home because father passed away. Oh. And then I flew back, and then I flew straight back to Greenville, and then... Because I had an invite to the X Games, and I was like, I'm not missing it. You know, I want to go just even for the experience. So I flew back to Greenville, was hanging out. I didn't get to ride that much just because there wasn't really that many good spots, and sort of the ramp riders had a different sort of schedule, I guess. So did that, and then I come back to Long Beach for a week just before the contest. And then I just... practiced as much as I could, and then, but the fact that I hadn't, you know, had a lot of practice sort of previously, I sort of had no expectations, so I was just like, all right, I'm gonna go to the contest, enjoy myself. And I had a bad sleep the night before. And
a bad sleep, really?
I was a bit nervous.
So this seems like really everything was not going in your favor. Like, I mean, you weren't practicing like crazy before it. You didn't get a great night's sleep before it. Was everybody you were competing against, were they already like your friends, or were they like my Flatland heroes? Were they the dudes you were in awe of?
It was sort of my generation, so okay. There wasn't really like, you know, it wasn't Kevin or Chase or anyone
right,
entering.
Yeah.
It was, yeah, our generation and stuff. So, and then I was just like, it's cool. Like, I'm super stoked to be here. That's mm-hmm. all that really matters, you know. So just went there and ended up riding good. I guess, like, the previous years, I'd been sort of building my skill up and getting, like, the mentality right for contests sort of.
So is this your first X Games, or had you been in it before?
No, that was my first X Games. Okay. My only X Games.
Because that was the last Flatland one, right, too?
Yeah.
That's so insane. Yeah, yeah. I just did the math in my head and figured that out, yeah.
So good. So
you shut it the whole thing down. They were like, we can't have this Australian guy winning this shit. We got to just destroy it. Yeah. But so was there any, like, was it a dramatic contest in the sense that, like, you thought that you weren't going to win and then you surged ahead? Or was it like that? Or was it just you did your thing and you just happened to score well?
I was pretty happy with my tricks. Like, I had some good tricks at the time, mm-hmm. like kick flips, blender flips, stuff like that. Me and Penenzek were a bit close. Marty Quapper mm-hmm. was the last one to ride. And the previous year, I think he won the contest on his last run. So okay. I was a bit scared.
He's clutch. He had the clutch skills, yeah.
For sure. So, but, yeah, when I was all done and dusted, it was like just this massive weight was lifted.
Yeah, so when they read off your name and say, hey, you won, like, how did you feel?
This is the best. yeah.
How did it change things back in Australia? Because I remember when I went over there to your house after that, you know, we did, like, a radio show.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Interviewed and all that stuff. How did it change things back in this?
You become a bit more of, like, a local celebrity and
yeah.
stuff?
A little bit, yeah. Like, sort of, yeah, put the place on the map a little bit. And people gave me a bit more respect. Like, you know, people knew that I rode and stuff, and that's right. cool. But if you win such a prestigious,
yeah.
you know, medal or event, like,
all of a sudden it's like, oh, you weren't just ride by yourself in a parking yeah. lot. You were actually building it. It's something yeah. that they could understand. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But so you're doing all the local news and stuff like that? Or?
Yeah, pretty much. Just, yeah, coverage back home and people that were stoked and sort of trying to get me coverage as well. And then I was just, like, so keen to ride harder. And then that's when I probably started working on my first solo DVD, okay. maybe.
Did you win, like, an absurd amount of money? Or did it seem absurd, at least?
unfortunately, California has its California tax.
And Australian tax, I'm assuming, too, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so I think it was, like, 20-something thousand, and then California took 30%, and then I ended up, like, with 13, so.
That's brutal.
But still. But the medal, I got
yeah, yeah, that's an important part. But, yeah, that is crazy. 30% just off the top, that's fucked.
Yeah.
Damn. That's cool, though. But so, okay, so what was your motivation with, like, I'm going to do a solo DVD? Because had anyone done this in Flatland prior, or was this a new concept?
yeah, well, I think there had been a few solo videos coming out.
Maybe Vicky.
Yeah.
Okay.
Marty,
yeah.
Around that same time.
So, like, I had all these good competition tricks, and, like, I knew myself, like, there's so much more that I had that I'd do back home that I couldn't show people, you know? Because,
right,
like, sometimes, you know, you can't get everything consistent sort of thing unless you're Trevor Meyer.
You can't turn everything into a contest trick.
Yeah, that's right. So I was like, all right, well, I'll start documenting all these good tricks that I can do because, you know, I got these awesome tricks that I'd love to show my mates, like, back in America and Europe and stuff, and just did that and... Yeah, I got my first video, got a lot of good recognition, so...
But so, how many actual minutes of riding might have the DVD consisted of? I gotta admit, I haven't actually seen it. I would like to go back and watch it now. Is it online?
Yeah, sure. All sections are, anyway.
Okay,
so
yeah, yeah.
My mate, Stuart Munro,
Yeah,
he's been...
Shout out to him. He's the one who told me, like, you gotta interview him, so...
Yeah.
Shout out to Stuart.
At Stuart Munro video.
Yeah.
And we're working on a video at the moment as well,
okay.
so... Yeah, can't wait for that.
So if you had lived in like a scene of people at the time, would you have probably been like, okay, we're gonna all make a video together? But was it more like, because it's funny for people to think like the internet wasn't really around then, so if you wanted to put out a video part of yourself, which now it probably would just be a video, like a web video or whatever, then you, like a DVD was kind of the only realistic way you could do it.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, so just collected all that footage for 2-3 years. 2006, I released it. I got like 1,000 copies made. I think I sold about 700-800 copies, which is awesome. I was very happy with that. And yeah, it was great. Sort of all over. Got really good recognition, and I got a couple of sections in there. Really, like, you know, I'm proud of, like. Yeah. You know, really hard tricks and stuff like that.
And so how long was the whole thing, basically?
30, 40 minutes.
And was it all riding, or was there a lot of...
I was sort of, around the time, my brothers were bodyboarding a lot.
Okay.
And I got a lot of respect for, you know, even though maybe personalities in different sports, you know, vary compared to or conflict with BMX personalities, but...
Right.
I got a lot of respect for, you know, if you're good at what you do, you deserve respect. So I wanted to, and back home, like being friends with all these, you know, skaters, bodyboarders, freestyle, MX dudes, I wanted to show my friends. So yeah, sort of included them. It was good. Like, not so far from my place, there was a freestyle MX, FMX compound. I don't know if you know Robbie Madison.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah. I went to his premiere for one of the videos that he did for DC.
The Pipe Dream or something?
Yeah, it was him just riding off a huge container into this really steep wedge. It was pretty sick, yeah. And I was with my Australian friend Liam Zingbergs, and he was telling me, like, you don't even understand. Like, to my dad, this guy is a fucking god. Like, he's huge in Australia, yeah.
So he's a local boy. And
okay, cool.
Yeah, so sort of... I'd go and watch them a bit and sort of film and sort of stuff like that.
Wait, he's from your actual, like, town, like the small area that you're from, or generally speaking he's from?
Generally speaking, like, he actually grew up in this place called Kiama, like 40 minutes away.
Right.
But now he's, like, lives sort of, like, his home base is, like, 30 minutes away, so.
Nice.
Yeah, if he's not in America.
Bobby, so do you remember how you felt or what the reaction was when his first video came out?
He came back to LA, stayed at my house around the exact time he sent me the DVD.
Okay.
And it arrived, and we premiered it at my in my apartment with the other local riders here. And I mean, everyone was like pretty much floored. This Simon's got tricks, like techniques that span like decades, you know what I mean? All these different eras. And he pretty much was like a master of the bike, you know what I mean?
So, yeah.
Like, just seeing all those different tricks put together in a certain way, you know what I mean, was crazy. Everyone was just mind-blown, really.
That's interesting. You say it, like, spanned multiple generations. Like, is that something that you're conscious of, is that you have, like, an extremely wide variety of tricks from different eras?
That pretty much stems from watching the Dorkin videos.
Right.
Like, you know, Kevin, Chase, they're masters of the front and back wheel,
right?
Basically. So, and Chad DeGroote, phenomenal.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where so much of my motivation comes from. And I was just like, I want to learn it all. I want to do it. I want to do it all. So, but, you know, and then sort of started thinking more about style and stuff like that. And then what tricks that I preferred to do and what, you know, I'd like to turn into my sort of genre, sort of thing. So, what I'm known for, sort of thing. So
it's hard to get him to elaborate on his own contribution. He's kind of humble. That's sick though. I mean, I'm trying to get a perspective for like what the overall feel was when it came out. Like when it came out, did you get such a good reaction that you knew that you had to do another one?
Yeah. Well, because I sold a bunch of copies and I got so much good feedback on it. And to this day, like, people are still like, oh, you know, that is very motivating. And when, you know, people come up to you and say, oh, you know, really motivated from what you did.
Right.
You're just like, wow, that's, that's awesome.
And was it all self-filmed as well, or did you have people help you?
Yeah, pretty much. Like, just family members, if they could spare the time.
Right.
Or friends, or, you know, whatever. Sometimes tripod shots. Yeah. Just, you know, whatever I could do to, you know, get that. So, yeah.
Seeing a solo DVD allowed, you know, all the riders to see a pro rider do their absolute highest level of riding.
Right.
They may have pulled these tricks once or twice in their life.
Yeah.
So you're actually seeing like the very cutting edge of where the progression is for any particular rider.
Yeah.
Which is different than seeing their, you know, perfected contest routine and stuff. So it's really like mind blowing to really see what the cutting edge of riding is for each person that does a solo DVD.
Do you get a lot of joy out of like getting tricks so dialed that you could do them in a contest, or is it more satisfying for you to just pull that thing one time that you might never be able to do again?
Probably the most satisfaction comes from just laying out some amazing combo, even if you can't get it again.
Right. But are you happy with that? If you pulled like the hardest trick that you've been thinking about for a year and you do it one time, are you cool with never doing it again?
As long as I film it.
Yeah, really? That could just be the end of it?
Yeah, pretty much.
That's cool.
But, you know, like my backwards kickflip one, like I'm stoked to, you know, some tricks are just too hard to get consistent in flatland.
Right.
And, but stuff like my kickflip and blender flip, like I think they're really good tricks, and they weren't at a level that I couldn't get them consistent. So,
right.
I mean, that is also very satisfying if you can do them in a contest. Like, awesome. But my most satisfaction comes from if you pulled like an amazing combo and filmed it. Yeah, yeah. That's yeah.
When you look at all the young kids in flatland now, like how do you view them? Like when you look at all these little superstar kids out there that are getting a lot of attention and killing it, like what's your impression of the younger generation?
I'm embarrassed that I wasn't doing amazing stuff at 9 years old.
Oh yeah, because there's a ton of like super kids now too, right?
yeah it's crazy. That's I just hope they keep going, you know, like, and once you know like with some people how you'll hit your late teens, get a car, stuff like that.
Right.
I hope they don't do that.
Yeah.
Because like some footage that I've seen recently of, you know, 9-year-old kids in Japan that just beat most people.
Really?
Stupid. That's so good.
Bobby was just giving you credit for being like super well-rounded and having like a wide breadth of influences. You look at younger riders and you think that it's kind of weird because they probably are coming from a much more specific point of influence. Like they're probably not influenced by the same old videos that you know about.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good point.
Is the modern style, is it strange to you, or is it a cool, is it just awesome?
Yeah, it's definitely, I don't know, like growing up in my era, I liked the fact that you sort of were trying to be an all-rounder sort of master of your bike,
mm-hmm.
you know what I mean? And now you've got this changed style to where it's usually either front or back wheel, like
right.
one or the other.
Do you think that's strange that flatland has become so polarized in that way where people usually focus on one?
Yeah, a little bit. But having said that, like, you know, if you can master, to say, the back wheel even more, like, and that's what it takes to do that, like, I'm all for it for right. sure. But it's just different, you know, it's right. like...
Like somebody can just take it to the next level, basically, yeah.
if they're really, really specialized. Yeah. The same way that like a flatlander who rides flatland and street is probably not ever going to be the best flatlander if he's spending a lot of his time doing something else as well. Yeah,
yeah.
It's that's pretty insane to think that it's come to that point where it's like you kind of have to make a decision.
Yeah.
But that, you know, wasn't a part of your generation. Look, can we talk about bike setup? Because I know that you've stayed true to the brakes, even though a lot of people have taken them off over the years. What did you ever consider taking them off?
Yeah, yeah. Back in the day, I took them off for a bit. And, you know, at times, like, I have just a front brake or just a back brake or, you know, no brakes at all. But I don't know, the double front brakes have really sort of stuck with me, I guess. I've just enjoyed it. I've sort of really gone to a bit of a new setup recently, so they're a little bit sort of maybe the tricks, a couple of the tricks that I'm doing that were more specialized for the double front brakes, I might not be doing those so much anymore.
Wait, so what's the new setup?
got a new Colony Flatland range has come out.
Oh, okay.
And the bars are a lot bigger than what I used to run, so they're like a two-piece now. And more, the frame's more like just normal BMX style.
Uh-huh.
And yeah, so I guess a lot of companies have sort of dropped out of Flatland a bit, and Colony's sort of stepped up. And
so they're stepping up because they kind of took a step back a few years ago, right?
Yeah, yeah, they did a Flatland range and had a signature frame, and so did another guy, Shane.
Uh-huh.
But they didn't really do that well, which is fine. But and so took a break from it, and then Clint, you know, who used to be a bit of a Flatlander himself, or you know, get into it a little bit. He's decided to give it another crack because for the respect of Flatland,
yeah.
Which is good.
That's
and
awesome.
Yeah, so we've just come up with, you know, just the basic sort of frame, like, which is all the rage these days, and two-piece bars.
Is there anything special about the frame?
Yeah,
I know you
yeah.
and Shane kind of collaborated on it.
Yeah. basically, it's the geometry, 75 head angle, 18.9 top tube. I'm not 100% sure about the back end, but it's good. It's a good length. So because mm-hmm. we had a sample, but the back end was too short and I wasn't feeling it. So we changed that and it's really nice now. So it did got pegs, a stem, really nice. The Flatland stems are really nice.
Hey.
Yeah, I really like that. The two piece bars, really good, very nice. Yeah, just a chain wheel and just a few other basic sort of things. But
do you miss the wacky looking Flatland bikes of the 90s in comparison to now, where Flatland bikes kind of look like every other BMX bike to a certain extent?
Actually, don't. Nah, I don't miss
this
it.
Isn't a nostalgic thing for Flatlanders. So, like, you don't look back at the crazy frames and you're like, oh, man, that'd be cool to have a wacky down tube again. Yeah.
Yeah. I liked the bent down tube for a bit.
Right, yeah.
But
that's got to be kind of helpful to have that out of the way.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. I started on a Big Daddy, other bikes, but my first real Flatland was a Big Daddy, which is like a BMX bike, but with a platform. So
right.
I've always sort of liked that anyway, but like real crazy looking Flatland frames, I've never been a fan of really anyway. Just it's, I don't know, just too crazy, you know, just, yeah. I think sometimes when you do have that crazy sort of geometry tubes, it can just affect the weighting of the bike,
uh-huh.
which area it's sort of, yeah, because my last, before I had my signature bike, which was the seat stays were down a fair bit, I could do whoppers before that, but once I got that bike, I was having a bit of trouble, so I just felt the weight sort of, it just changed a little bit,
right.
So I don't know, but anyway.
Well, yeah, so. That's cool. I'm going to have to, I just want to mention that Stuart Monroe volunteered a lot of really fucking good questions here. So Bobby, if you have any questions as well, feel free to jump in, but I'm going to be, a few of these are going to not be from my mind. They're from his. He said, what's it like having the most watched web video? Which I did not know that was true, but is that true?
Pretty much.
It's on YouTube?
I'm not sure if it is right now. I've seen some other ones, but it's got like 10 million views. Like,
really? That might be it. But I'm going to go on YouTube right now and just search. Yeah. But it's,
and
10 million.
It's like, it's got two versions of it. One of it you can look under Simon O'Brien, and the other one you look under Hilltop Hoods. And both, like, basically all of my web edits, like, combined is like 20 million views, I think.
Jeez.
So, yeah.
Oh, yeah, there it is.
I remember it was like
9 years ago, BMX Flatland, best rider,
yeah.
?
Best rider, I mean, that's straight SEO.
Yeah, that's smart,
I mean?
Yeah. And it, 9 years ago is so old for YouTube, too, 2006. That's like, if you put something BMX related on YouTube back in the day, like back then, you had a very good chance of it getting a shitload of views because there was so little on YouTube and people were searching for it.
Yeah. I remember one day my brother was on the net on YouTube, and before back in the day when it come up and they had all the the pictures of the different sports or whatever.
Right.
Like before you sort of, and mine was up there. My brother's like, yeah, check this out. So I'm up there, so it was good.
Damn, 10 million views though. Have you had a lot of people who kind of knew about you from that just because that's been so heavily watched?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So, which is awesome.
Yeah,
so,
that's sick. Yeah. What is that video? Is it from...
that video was...
Oh, it's from the... Oh, no, that's... is it from a DVD or anything?
Nah.
It's just like, a single clip?
Yeah. It's the very first clip that I sort of put together. So, like, it's pretty average, but some of the tricks are really good. Like, some of the tricks are really good. Bobby filmed a couple of them when he was out in Australia. And, I just... At the time, that song, not the best song, but it was pretty popular in Australia and stuff. And I was just like, put it together, and I just wanted to put a clip together, basically, and just to show my mates, like this, because this was before I did my first solo video.
Right.
And, and then somebody uploaded it, which I didn't want them to.
At the time.
Yeah, but now.
But now you're like, damn, that was pretty cool. Yeah, thanks. Appreciate it. Like BMX Flatlander 13 or whatever his username is. sure. Hey, so he said, what's the story with having a stroke at the end of the year, and how did that affect your life and riding? You had a stroke.
Yeah, it was crazy. Middle of last year, I started studying, doing a work health and safety diploma. So I didn't have a lot of work since then, and I was studying a lot. One night I was studying through the day, and I watched a movie that night. I was just about to go to bed, setting my alarm clock, and just I don't know if you ever listen to anybody like about the what a stroke feels like. It's like a big release into your brain. And so I was standing there doing my clock, this crazy release feeling into my brain. I felt like my eyes sort of receded into my head. And then, my eyesight was, if you do cross-eyed blurry vision, multiply that by 10, my eyes just went crazy. And then I was like, this is really, really, really not right. But I wasn't sure what was happening. And so I checked my strength and, just to see if I was all right. And I was like, oh, maybe I've just had a brain fart or something. And I'll go to bed and I'll sleep it off. And, hopefully tomorrow I'll be okay. And so I woke up the next morning. As soon as I opened my eyes, I knew there was something wrong. I can only open this eye, my left eye. And sort of stumbled to the bathroom trying to open this eye. I looked in the mirror and I had to physically lift my right eyelid, and my right eye had turned right out to the right.
Wow.
So I was like, wow, I've got crazy eyes. I was just like, my life just, I was like, oh no, I hope this is not stuck like this. And
you were just going to take it, just accept this for the rest of my life. My eyes are crossed out for later.
Yeah, pretty much. I was so scared. I was so scared. And I was like, all right, got taken to hospital, and then just, had some aspirin, and sort of just got checked. Stayed in there for a couple of days. After I had aspirin, the next morning, which is crazy, my eye come back. I was just like, that's phenomenal.
Yeah.
It was just awesome. So good. And then, but what had happened, the blood clot stopped on my brain stem.
Okay.
And then it affected my third nerve, and which affects your eyesight. So I had really bad double vision for a while. And that lasted a month, maybe.
Really?
Maybe 1 to 2 months. And so I was out of hospital after a few days, and back home, and went to see the doctor, and I went and saw a kinesiologist, and just got, advice on how to sort of get better.
Right.
And got some eye exercises and stuff, and so it took maybe 3 to 4 months, maybe, until my eyesight was pretty good. So it was really sort of when it happened, like when I was recovering, like there was a few points where it healed really quickly, and then it got to a certain point, and then it just healed slowly.
Right.
And then I just had to do the exercise.
Was this like stress induced? Because you said you were studying a lot that day. Was that?
Yeah, it's crazy. Like I had all these theories, like what it could have been, mm-hmm. like stress or my OCD, or you know whether. You know,
losing your mind in general. Yeah. You know, like I'm fucked. Yeah,
for sure. And the doctor's like, nah, it's none of that. It's just like
he said, it was just random.
Yeah, they couldn't. Well, I did all these tests, a few MRIs, all that sort of jazz, and they couldn't find what happened. Like the scar tissue healed up, which is good, but couldn't find out why it happened.
Did you have any other afflictions to like? Your arms.
Yeah, did it mess you up riding-wise after?
Yeah, nah. Well, I couldn't. There was nothing else. It was mainly just my eyes.
Okay.
And then I couldn't ride for five months or something. Yeah. 4 or 5 months. And during this time, like, I've been working on this video with Stuart.
Right.
And so that just took a massive chunk, and that was depressing.
Yeah.
And then so... You know, so...
But no lasting ramifications from this? So
I'm good now.
Well,
so,
that's good.
Yeah, I've been working for a few months now, sort of casually and stuff, at a construction, sort of big flour. It's like the biggest in the Southern Hemisphere flour mill thing and ethanol plant and stuff. So it's not the best, but it's work at the moment. So I'll do that and... So it's good. It's good that I'm healed.
Yeah.
Yeah. You've done, talking about work. I know besides just like trying to go to contests and stuff, you've done other types of, like theater performing arts stuff, like Tokyo Disney. Mm. You did some other theater thing around Australia too.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, I've been super lucky, like being, you know, the best flatlander in Australia, like, being,
Is that a tough judgment to make, or is that just kind of obvious?
it's pretty obvious.
Well, there's one other dude, Nick Watts, but he doesn't ride anymore. So.
Oh, he's a legend. That dude's legendary, actually. Yeah.
Yeah. But, so, you know, for any flatland jobs, like, I've been lucky to get, I did one. It was, like, a theatre performance. Mm-hmm. So it was about street culture. Taking it to the theater. So it was like there was a b-boy, a skater, an acrobat, a dancer, a singer, and a flatlander.
Yeah.
And so it was like, you know, at times we had a full street sort of environment on the stage, and it's just like exploring relationships between the different you know, between the acrobat and the BMXer.
Acting in it as well as riding in it?
Yeah, sort of acting, yeah. Like, not really acting. It was more, I guess. I don't know what you'd call it.
Have you done a lot of, like, demos and shows? Have you gotten into that in the past as well?
Yeah, I've been real lucky with a couple of jobs as well. Had a Thai government sports job where... Went to Thailand for 3 months to coach all these Thai flatlanders for like an Asian sort of.
Asian indoor games?
Yeah, possibly. But it excluded Japan. I'm not sure why, but just a bunch of those sort of.
That's interesting.
Different Asian countries. And then I was lucky, very, very lucky, to get a 3-month job in Tokyo Disneyland.
Really?
And that was probably one of my best jobs I've ever had. Just really cruisy.
Just fun? The money was good, I'm assuming?
Yeah, real good. Had to hustle a little bit for it because normally they don't pay very well, unfortunately. But I had, like, my mate Mike Daly back in Australia sort of hustle for us and get us... good money. So
really? 3 months in Tokyo though, were you taking in the sights and going all around, or were you just riding and working? Or
we had one day off a week. Okay. So I was whatever we could do in that day, just cruise around, go and check out the sights. You know.
When you go to Japan, and Japan has a huge flatland scene, does everybody know who you are? Do you get a lot of respect, or is the scene so young that they don't necessarily know about the rest of the world?
One thing about Japan, as you probably know, like, the riders would just give you respect, you know.
True. As you just saw, I just got bowed to by a Japanese customer out there, yeah.
which is great, you know.
I love the bow.
Yeah.
You ever see them doing, like, the 18 bows in a row, like, bowing over and over to somebody? It's, like, an ultimate sign of respect. It's crazy.
For sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, Japan's just, you know, you get the respect from the riders, you get looked after. Yeah, I'm pretty...
Talk about Circle of Balance, because you were at the last Circle of Balance. That was in Kyoto, Japan.
Mm, yeah.
So how was that competition? And yeah. Especially compared to, like, all the other, I mean, X Games and all the other stuff you've done.
Yeah. Well, basically, like, yeah, it was another Red Bull Circle of Balance in Kyoto, thank goodness. It was, yeah, amazing. And, you know... Red Bull and Japan combined really, really looked after the riders,
right.
Put on just, yeah, epic little adventure, pretty much. It was like, yeah, it was just, just a few days, but amazing, you know, just, you know, the whole kit and caboodle just got looked after.
I like really modern well. Flatland costume contests, are they more fun than they used to be back in the day with the X Games, where it was, you were put in this weird corporate box?
I think, like, the older ones, like, you know, CFBs and all those, sort of maybe more fun, but, like, you know, stuff like the Red Bull Circle Balance, I guess, gives the riders the recognition they deserve,
right.
And, but still, you know, it is what you make it,
yeah.
Really, and, I guess a Red Bull Circle Balance is not strict like ESPN used to be or anything. So
yeah, it's a little bit more open to, like, what flatland really is.
Yeah, right. Yeah, absolutely.
But then again, it's not seen on ESPN by millions of people. So
yeah.
It's a give and take, huh?
Yeah, for sure.
Stuart said, what about the video project that you're working on now, which I believe that he's producing it. So
yeah, at Stuart Munro Video. Yeah, he's Stuart did... the Colony video years,
right, yep.
Years ago. He's got some really good work, and he does a lot of music videos as well these days. But this project we've been working on, Stuart loves flatland,
right.
And he's done some flatland videos before, and he wanted to work on another project. So sort of just asked a bunch of people, and sort of sometimes I get a bit lazy with my writing in a way, and he sort of, in a way, like, he wanted to come up with this idea as well, just to get me sort of try and do more harder tricks and progress again and stuff like that, which has been really good, because if you have a project that you're working towards, then...
That's going to motivate the hell out of you, yeah.
Absolutely. So it's been really good. And then so I put out an edit sort of late last year, and ever since I finished that, then I've been filming... for this project,
right.
And I've got about 17 runs, probably 10 really good runs, and I'm really happy what we've done, all the people we've been getting involved. I'm filming a bunch out here for it.
Hell yeah.
Filming Bobby a bit, and down in Long Beach at the Pistoleros Jam, bunch of dudes. So it's gonna be sick. It's Stuart does good work,
yeah.
And the vision he has for the video is really good, because just we've been talking about it, so it's gonna be good.
Stuart said, "What's it like living in a small surf town, and has that affected your riding style and tricks in any way?" I just want to know: do you like living there, or do you aspire to ever live anywhere else, or do you like living in that kind of environment?
Yeah, it's funny. Like back in the day, like. I'm a bit of a family sort of person, so
right.
I sort of wanted to, back younger, wanted to be around my brothers sort of growing up or whatever. But now I sort of regret it a little bit. I should have just...
Right, yeah. If you had made the move to a big city, you might have more opportunities.
Yeah. And at that time, like, I did enjoy going to the surf a bit and doing stuff like that, but... I think as you get older, you're just like, you're running out of time to accomplish or take opportunities. So
right.
I sort of regret that a little bit, but living in an area like that where there's not a lot to do and you've got a passion, then you know, you're not, there's not going to be a lot of things that get in the road. So, which has been good. And sort of riding by myself, I'm not really sort of looking to other people like what my riding style or tricks should be apart from videos. So I think that's helped me go in my own direction, more or less, sort of.
Because if you were in LA, you'd have all these temptations and different things that you could be doing that kind of take you away from your goal, I guess.
That's right, absolutely. And I think if you go to a big scene, like in Japan, like at the moment, you know, Bucci's made, you know, the back wheel amazing. So you got so many people doing similar back wheel combos.
Right.
And it just, you know, I mean, it's amazing and stuff. But sometimes I find it gets a bit, you know, you've sort of seen it all
before. I got a question.
What's one trick that you've always wanted to do but haven't pulled it off yet?
Yeah.
He's done them all.
Sure. I don't know. That's
either a trick you gave up on or a future dream trick.
Yeah.
Both would be acceptable, I think, right?
There's a one trick that I touched on, but like I pulled it, but then just the ride out I touched on, which is a like a backwards half packer full kickflip. So like that was really, 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 really hard. And I pulled it, but I just touched on the ride out. So, I mean, it'd be nice to get that again, but...
but is that the kind of thing that you would sit down and film for this video project that you're working on now? Would you be willing to make that commitment? But are we talking like, are we talking days or are we talking hours or are we talking weeks in terms of how long it might take for you to get this on footage?
Because I've got really close before, probably, you know, it's one of those tricks. It's a hit or miss and it just, it's like on the borderline, you can sort of get it, sort of can't sort of thing. So I was pretty lucky the day I got it. But I might have another go. I'll see what happens when I get home.
It's like submitting yourself for like a mental trial when you do that, right? Because you know you're going to kind of drive yourself crazy trying it.
Sure.
Yeah. How does it feel being like, from everything I've read about you from all your peers and people who've interviewed and everything, it just, they always seem to mention the fact that you are one of the greatest of all time and doesn't seem like there's any argument there. Bobby, like, I'm sure you could vouch for this or you could give your perspective on his riding, but is it weird being, you know, a person who's still alive, still riding, and to have people talk about you in such a way?
every time I hear that, I'm honored. Like, it's you know, because, you know, when I started BMX, like, it's just like anybody skill level at like starts, you start from nothing and you build it. So it's like it's such a gradual thing that you don't think, oh, you know, you know, I just think, you know, there's so many good riders. Like, right. I don't...
Seems impossible that you could be considered special at all, never mind one of the best.
Yeah, that's right. So it's just... but the main good thing about being considered good is, like I said, like when people say, you know, you've motivated me, you know, like people have motivated me in the past, like the Dorkin guys, and... I appreciate, you know, it's amazing when people say that.
Hell yeah. I'm just looking through some more Stewart's question here. Who is Nick Watts? You mentioned him, right?
Yeah. So he is a rider from Melbourne. He sort of years, he's like a little bit sort of before me,
okay,
sort of thing in the timeline.
How old are you again?
36.
Okay, so he's a bit older than you.
Yeah.
All right.
And he still rides a little bit, but he's very, I don't know, like he doesn't want to show his stuff. It's really weird. Like, I don't know. He's a bit of a funny guy. He's great, but he's funny. So, like, a lot of his old stuff, like, even to this day, like, holds up. Like, he's got a really quick, whippy sort of style. Like,
he pulls off, like, a million tricks and, like, very so small amount of time.
Was he a big influence for you, or
not really? Because he lives like 14 hours away. no, he didn't ride with me ever. because he's like that. And so, yeah, but he's got amazing footage, and yeah, it's just funny how it's funny, like, about filming, like, because he started off filming BMX and all that sort of stuff as well, and now he's got some crazy time-lapse sort of company that do thing, set up time-lapses for big construction companies or whoever. It's just, like, I find that pretty amazing about, you know, BMX, like, and everybody sort of wanting to start filming, like, right. Document their own BMX sort of stuff and where it can lead. Yeah, like, you know, even Bobby as well, like, with, you know, all the amazing editing he does, and yeah, all right, that's pretty crazy.
So, Stuart also said you've done some crazy lip tricks on mini ramps that not many other riders have done. Is it hard coming up with those? How often do you ride parks? Do you really care about park riding?
sort of the park I go to is like 40 minutes away, mm-hmm. 40 minute drive. I find it fun, yeah, like adding in a bit of flatland sort of thing, like stuff like nose wheelie to boomerang to Canadian in and doing hula hoops, you know, endo hula hoops and that. I like BMX. Yeah. I love BMX.
Is that more just like relax? Is it just a change of pace to go and do mini ramp stuff or skate park stuff?
Yeah, absolutely. And it's a creative on a different level, right. You know, sort of thing. It's just another section of BMX that it's amazing and it's great fun. And, you know, it's good to try and be creative in that area, you know. It's like,
yeah,
just whatever
is
BMX.
Is it true you broke your neck while you were asleep?
Not while I was asleep. There was one day.
That sounds hard to break your neck while you're asleep, yeah.
That was pretty crazy.
Let's hear it.
Stuart.
Yeah. Stuart's just throwing a monkey wrench in this whole interview.
well, back in the day, before I came to America, I had my Big Daddy, pretty heavy bike.
Mm-hmm.
I was doing this one trick all day, or, you know, for hours, like, where I sort of jumped and then I sort of landed on the bike and my hands were sort of pulling down. By the end of the day, I don't think I'd eaten much or whatever, and then by the end of that end of the day, my neck was stinging. And I was like, oh, it's crazy, it's so sore. So I was lying down or whatever and just wondering why it was so sore, and I ended up getting an x-ray, and just one of the vertebrae, like the back part of the vertebrae that sort of holds some of the tendons, it just cracked down. So it was not a bad break, but it still hurt.
And that definitely does not sound like you were asleep.
Yeah.
Stuart, get your fucking facts straight. Hey, Shane Badman, your boy, he said $1 million or the chance to ride forever is on the table. Which do you choose? That's an interesting question because, you know, you could ride forever, theoretically, but presumably when you're 65, it's going to be very difficult.
Yeah, absolutely. That's it. Probably ride, because over the past few years, I've been searching for a career, sort of going through the whole, you know, what's more important, you know, sort of being happy, money, stuff like that. And, you know, circumstances and jobs I've tried and that is, you know, definitely BMX makes me happy.
Yeah.
You know, and I know if you got the $1 million, you'd be happy for a little while.
But if you couldn't ride at all, you can't do the one thing that you actually really give a fuck about. That sounds pretty torturous. Yeah.
That's right. So
yeah,
I'd probably take the riding.
Yeah. So you definitely still see. So basically, have you been trying to find a career that you actually care about enough to make that your life? But you're still kind of in the mentality, from what I hear, is that you basically work so you can ride rather than, you know, working and having that really matter to you. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, pretty much. Just, you know, prices are just to live. Like, it's getting more and more and more expensive.
This is true.
And,
hey,
fucking capitalism.
Sorry to cut in, but talk about the Navy, because you joined the Navy for a little bit and then got out. Mm. So how does that factor in?
Yeah, that was a bad choice. I'll start by saying that. don't do it, guys.
How long were you actually... Yeah, how did this happen? This is strange.
So the area that I live in, there's a Navy base. There's a couple, actually. And so,
so you're just having a bad day, just walk over there, like, sign me up?
Pretty much.
Really? All right.
A bad day that lasted a few months. So, yeah, did that. And because my brother had been in the army, I was like, oh, you know. And, you know, because where I worked at the supermarket for a while, I was still working there. And it was like, it just seems like these people have this good job. But, you know, sometimes things can be a facade or, yeah, you know, a uniform might not actually tell you what the job's like.
Well, it's in people's best interest to keep up a front, like they're, yeah, really happy and content, even if they're not. Yeah,
yeah, that's right. And I think, like, it's pretty, you know, it's a government job, so it can be pretty cruisy, but just when I went there, like recruit school, stuff like that, I was only there for a year. I wanted to get a trade, so, and just be paid, like, as trainee or apprenticeships in Australia, just like $300 a week.
Right.
It's too hard to live on, pretty much. And so I wanted to do it, making a little bit more money at the time while I got a trade. And just I had a bit of trouble with the course. I don't know whether it had a bit to do with the physics. It was pretty hard. And it was electronics, and that was, some of the physics was a bit messed up.
Mm-hmm.
But also being there, like, just school mentality.
Yeah, like, it's very, you're being disciplined, yeah, bossing you around, yeah.
And even, like, the other people that join, yeah, like I'm a bit reserved and whatever, but I've seen a lot of life, you know, I've been around the world, I've done a lot of things in my life. And a lot of, you know, young people that join and, you know, some, you know, bullying and all that shit.
I can't imagine you fitting in that well with the average, like, knucklehead Australian guy, yeah, who wants to go kill somebody.
Yeah, pretty much.
Hey, were you able to ride during that point?
Nah. So for
but did you think you were going to be able to?
Because
I've heard about this, is that they sort of tell you, like, yeah, you're going to have time to ride when you sign up for the military, and it doesn't ever happen.
The defense lie so much.
Yeah, they do, huh? I mean, in America, same thing, I believe.
Because when I went to the recruit school, like, yeah, you go down here for X amount of time. You get down there, oh, the course has changed. You're here for another few months, half a year. And you're just, hang on a second, I've got shit back home that, you know, I got to, like, look after, you know, my dog, my family, and, you know, I want to, and it's just like, this is it. Like, they just laugh at you pretty much. And
so how'd you get out of there?
Well, I failed the course, whether it's because, you know, the physics or whether I just wasn't happy being there. Maybe that had a lot to do with it. You know, if you're not happy, you're not going to work your best, are you? So that happened, and then they just offered me these really other crappy jobs, and I was like, there's no way. Like, I didn't come here to be in the defense. I came here to get a trade. So I was like, yeah, nah, I'm good. I'm going. So, and then now I'm just not working a whole lot, but I've been able to. And then I had my stroke and then got back. But now I'm in a pretty good situation. Loving life, being in LA, so yeah, you know, it's good.
Hey, so on a positive note, similarly positive note, have you ever had any public beefs with other Flatland pros?
Not really. Yeah, I just, you know, it's all good.
Stuart, like, posted a photo of Terry Adams sitting in front of his car and said, "What is your relationship with Terry Adams?" And for whatever reason, I assume that this means that you've had issues with him in the past.
No.
You friends?
Yeah. Me and Terry were rad, but we're good friends. But Stuart just likes giving him shit.
Yeah. He likes giving Terry shit. Oh, okay. Because I thought he was really trying to start some shit here. Yeah. Yeah.
But it's so funny because Terry knows that I don't say that, but Stuart just likes starting.
He's an antagonist, dude. I get that view of him. Yeah.
Hey, dude. Talk about the Australian scene, because not many, like, media places go to Australia and really cover it. So, like, when I was there, it seemed like Brisbane was kind of the main area where there's a lot of riders, but I know you live so far away from all of them, but do you travel around and link up with the other riders every so often, and, like, how does that work?
Yeah, they have a small Down Underground jam series that's sort of maybe three or four times a year, But the problem with Australia is it's so spread out, you know, sort of like America, really. But, you know, in Australia, there's only like four main cities, pretty right. much. And it's
ridiculously long drives between them.
Yeah, so I sort of, if it's at a local or I can get there, I will. It's just hard, you know. You know, you want to support the scene, but, you know, what cost is it at? And, you know, can you afford that time? Stuff like that. But, yeah, Australia's scene, it's flatland scene. It's not too bad, but there's just, I don't know, it just seems like it doesn't attract that many more riders, you know. Like, it's just, it seems like everybody wants to ride dirt and park. It's crazy.
So is that weird for you as somebody who's put your entire life into flatland to see it maybe being less popular on a mainstream level? Like, does that affect the way that you feel about it at all, or are you just kind of like, oh, it's a shame?
Yeah. What I don't understand is, like, you know, I watch a good flatlander, and you can see that what they're doing is absolutely looks amazing.
Yeah.
That's like, why aren't more people, like, interested in that? It's weird. Like,
I think it's because, like, in the modern, like, internet age, it's all about people wanting to watch things that are very, very similar to what they're doing.
Yeah, right.
More so than, like, wanting to watch something that's freakishly hard. It's sort of a strange era we're in where there's so much media out there that people don't leave their box as much, I feel, a lot of times. You know, there's so many options of things you could go watch on the internet right now.
Yeah.
It's strange.
Yeah, that's right. It's, yeah, it's a hard one.
That's one possible explanation. What about, like, what keeps you motivated to ride flatland? Like, you know, in that it's probably still kind of expensive. You still have to, like, you know, if you want to go somewhere to ride, you have to pay for your own flights at this point in your career and stuff. Like, do you ever think in your head, like, well, maybe I'm over this. Like, I'm just not going to do this anymore. I'm going to move on. Like, what keeps you motivated to actually keep learning stuff?
I'll definitely never be over it. I love the BMX community. I love, you know, the people that are into BMX. I just, you know, like, for LA, for instance, you know, I come here, I get treated like good friend, like, just get to see everything like a local.
Yeah.
Like, you cannot put a price on that.
That's true,
like,
yeah.
Like that.
When you think about the average, like, vacation experience for, like, a regular person, it's got to be pretty boring in comparison.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, you know, I've been, you know, every time, like, back home, like, I might whinge about, you know, something, or, you know, life's not going that great, my brother be like, dude, look at all the places you've traveled and what you've done.
Yeah,
and it's just like, yeah, that's right. And you know, my body works, so you can't complain,
really. As BMX riders, we always kind of take the traveling thing for granted sometimes, I think. Like, I was talking to one of my friends who was in jail recently, and he was talking to me about how, when he was telling the other inmates, like, yeah, I've been to Japan, I've been to Thailand, I've been to England, whatever. Like, that alone, never mind the fact that he made money riding and he has done all these other things and been on the cover of magazines. Like, just the traveling. Everybody he was locked up with, like, you know, mind blown. Like, that, yeah. They wanted to hear every fucking detail about Paris. You know, and that's kind of funny because to me, it's like, I'm surrounded by so many people that have been to Paris and they've been to Japan, and it's not that interesting to them at this point. But when you think about, like, regular dudes, I mean, that is a fucking pretty big accomplishment to be able to say you've seen a bunch of different continents, a bunch of countries, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. you know, one piece of advice I gave, like, anybody is travel. Mm. Like, you learn a bunch, you have that many memories, you know, you can't put a price on memories, just the stuff you get to do, like, you know. It's just phenomenal, like, what you can do when you travel.
What are some of your top spots that you've enjoyed going? Some highlights.
definitely LA, 100%. Sort of top of the list is LA and Japan, like those two. Yeah, or if not Tokyo, it's next level. Like Europe. Probably, I've been to Malaysia. I'm not really a fan of that. But basically, the top places would be America, Japan, and I love Australia. But, you know, when you're from a place, you just get over it a bit sometimes. But and it's just like, just the fact that I had this opportunity to come for my brother's wedding, I was like, you know, there's no way. I'm, you know, got to come to LA again, and just being so grateful that, yeah, super, super stoked.
So, Bobby, it's on you now, because I'm officially out of my list of questions and Stuart's volunteered list of questions. So anything stand out to you that maybe we should have discussed?
So as far as, like, riders that you looked up to from back in the day, you talked about Kevin and Chase and stuff, but were there any other riders that were, like, immediate to you that you looked up to, that you rode with, that really, you know, you wanted to either impress them or show them, you know, what you've learned or anything like that?
not in Australia, but the fact that people like Marty and Vicky were so determined as well to keep progressing the sport and coming up with new stuff, you know, that in itself is motivating. And, you know, when you're a competitive person yourself and want to be creative, that, you know, eggs you on, and just sort of, you don't want to, you want to show you're still got it as well. So it's, yeah, just, yeah, phenomenal.
So, like, you know, all these years you've, like, created different tricks, you're super original rider and stuff like that. At this point, do you feel like you lean more towards competition side or more, like, artistic side as far as flatland is concerned? Like, what does it mean to you now? You know what I mean?
Yeah. Definitely more artistic and filming. I still do... I do like competitions. It's just like, you just got to get in that right frame. You got a right frame of mind. You know, you got to work on tricks. You got to get stuff consistent. I'm not very consistent at the moment because I haven't been, you know, trying.
You never had like a reason to be if you're not doing contests all the time, right?
That's right. And, you know, working on videos, I just want to do a progressive video section. I think, but in the back of my mind, it's like, yeah, you know, I'd like to, you know, hit up the contest scene and show that I still got, you know, what it takes to be on the circuit and stuff. But, you know, money-wise, it's a bit hard as well. And, you know, it's expensive to travel all over to chase a circuit, so.
When you're working on a video part, like the one that you're working on now, is it kind of in the back of your head, like, this might be the last serious project that I film, so I definitely want to make this good because I might be nearing the end of that phase of my life?
Definitely. I think it's always good to put 100% into what you want to do. So, like, I, you know, everybody doesn't want to make a bad video section. Right. So it's like I've been putting in heaps of effort, but I know this is not going to be my last. Like, coming here, going to the Pistoleros Jam, like, you know, dudes 44, 45, still killing it.
That's awesome. Flatland has that going for it.
Yeah.
Thriving older guys. You know, it's not something where you know, in street riding, you're 45, it's kind of like, you know, you're really going to jump down a 15 stair.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's like that in itself is so motivating for me. It's like, yeah, man, I've got another 10 years at least, like, if I stay healthy.
Hell,
like,
yeah.
And, yeah, and it's like, yeah, even if I don't do the most, you know, crazy tricks, like, I'll still be able to just do some cool edits and just be creative, really, and have an outlet, so.
And you're, like, associated with, like, these biggest and baddest, like, a b-boy brand and stuff, too. Are you, like, trying to mix flatland, b-boy, street culture stuff still, like, with your sponsorships and all that stuff?
Yeah, well, I don't know if it goes back to the Dorkin days when, you know, Mark used to put all the b-boy in the Dorkin videos, but I sort of... This clothing brand, Biggest and Baddest, I actually, like, I don't buy clothes very much, but they had a couple of shirts and a jumper that I really, really liked, and I bought that, and then it turned out that my friend Mason Rose, who's a really good drop knee bodyboarder and photographer, filmographer, videographer, is good friends with the guys in Florida who own this, and so they're pretty much the biggest... b-boy clothing company sort of thing. They do a lot for the breakdancing community.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so they're really, really good, really active, really, and not to mention their artwork on their stuff's like awesome. That's why I bought their stuff. And then Mason talked to the dude Max, and it's like, you know, hook Simon up, and yeah, I'm stoked. Like, really good quality clothes, and it's American brand.
It's always good seeing anybody who can take BMX and like put it into a context where other normal people can understand it. So
yeah.
I think like the b-boy hip hop thing, like Flatland probably kind of makes sense to them, at least visually. You know, you always see a Flatland guy in the back of a rap video and stuff like that. So
yeah,
do you think that could be like a future direction for Flatland, like putting it into those types of scenarios where it's like more street culture and stuff?
Yeah, 100%. Like you know, with the theater show that I did with the you know, b-boy skate, all that jazz. You know, you got Matthias and Vicky who are doing the demos at all the BC1 events. I'd done some demos for Mason back home for his b-boy events. You know, I think like Flatland and b-boys sort of on such a similar level sort of thing. So, you know, it's I think it goes well. And personally, like I love graffiti, love hip hop. So it's sort of right down my alley.
Favorite hip hop musicians currently?
Wu-Tang.
So you keep it old school mostly?
Yeah. I got a lot of good old stuff. And I mean, I know a lot of people don't like Eminem, but...
Oh, fuck that. Not on this podcast. We've had many in-depth Eminem conversations on here, actually.
He's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Yeah, phenomenal. And just whatever's good, you know. You got to, yeah. Whatever's good listening, so...
Okay, we're getting close to the hour and a half mark. You got anything else burning in your mind that we might need to ask before we do the thanks?
I think that's about it. I think we've covered quite a bit of territory. Right?
I think I learned a lot, for sure, doing the research and the actual interview.
Yeah, cool.
Actually, there's a picture of Eminem, right? There's like a row of photos on my computer, and Eminem's one of them for some reason. And Lil Wayne and the Dragon Ball Z Pokemon kid. And Obama and some naked girl. So weird. Sure. But there is Eminem.
Nice.
Any thanks? Anything like when is the rough idea of when this video might come out that you're working on with Stuart?
Yeah. we're waiting to get some more footage off some people.
Uh-huh.
So he's started to drop it all on the timeline at the moment. I've given him all my footage. I'm just going to give him some more footage of America when I get back. Waiting for a bit more footage of people. It's going to be really good. He's got a lot of stock footage that he might give it a really good vibe, you know, a really good Flatland feel-good vibe we're aiming for. So it's going to be good. It's going to be real good.
Right.
And it'll be online, so have to check it out.
Yeah.
And
we'll push that. We'll try to make sure everybody sees it as much as possible.
Does it have a title yet? Or?
Not yet, no.
Okay.
So we'll come up with one. And Stuart always does good music, so music will be spot on for sure.
Nice.
And, so maybe start of next year, yeah. And... I might go home and try that other trick for it. I'll see.
That's dope. What about the thanks? Clint Miller?
Clint's
the obvious one.
Yeah, getting back into Flatland for the Colony. And look out for the Colony Exxon series. It's good stuff.
Oh, yeah.
And Biggest and Baddest in Florida. Really good quality clothes.
Nice.
All hip hop, graffiti. Sick. Hooking us up.
My pleasure. Yeah, because yesterday I got the email, or I was thinking about it. I saw the email and I was like, "Fuck, today is his last day to do it." And I knew that last night we were going to go to the strip club for my friend's birthday, Stevie's birthday. And I thought for a second, I was like, oh, maybe I should turn him down because there's no way I'm going to want to get up early. And then I was just like, nah, he just fucking came all the way from Australia. We got to get this out of it. Yeah, so
legend.
I'm glad that we did it because, I mean, I learned a lot. And this is the first real Flatland interview we've done since Mateus and Alex Jumlin. So, and we also did Tim Knoll, which is kind of a Flatlander of sorts.
Sweet.
But yeah,
he was just out for
so his podcast is coming out soon too. But thanks a ton for letting me interview you. Thanks a ton for Bobby for helping out, and thanks for Stuart for basically ghostwriting all the good questions. I kind of had the basic questions, but his were most of the in-depth ones.
Yeah, I just want to thank Stuart for hooking it up as well, helping us out, get this organized.
Yeah.
And thank Bobby for really looking after us in L.A., and I'm super stoked to be back in town because Love the West Coast. Sick.
Yeah. So to all the Flatland dudes out there, thank you very much for watching. And anybody who's stuck with us who doesn't ride Flatland, hopefully you learned a lot. I do want to send a shout out to Shad, because on his Snakebite podcast, which you can Google, he did an interview with Trevor Meyer. So that's another Flatland podcast you can go check out now, too. Shad's been doing some good, like, old school podcasts with various dudes. So give that a Google if you get a chance.
Yeah, that was really good,
actually. Yeah, I listened to that, too. Yeah. Trevor, because I remember meeting him in like a parking lot when I was like 14, and he had these crazy JNCOs on. He's about he's like a big old scarecrow, you know. He's just a very like interesting looking person, especially for me being like a really young kid. And like these JNCOs he's wearing, they did not fit. They were like way too short. But he's the kind of guy that like does not care at all about how he looks or anything like that. But that was a really cool interview. So I just wanted to give Shad and Trevor a shout out on that. But, yeah, shit, thanks a ton. To anybody watching at home, if you want to subscribe to the YouTube channel, it's also on SoundCloud and iTunes if you want to listen to it while you're driving around. And thank you very much to the boys, and thank you very much to anybody who listened to this. We appreciate it.
Thank you. Right. Thanks, Apes.
Yep, thanks for representing Flatland out here.
No doubt. I'm trying. I wish I had Catfish with me to give me some more specific knowledge, but he don't really know shit anyway either, so.
Lost in China somewhere.
Yeah, he's lost. He's in a hole right now. All right. Thank you very much, guys. Appreciate it.
All right. Thanks. Later.